Hello, everybody. Welcome back to We the People. My name is Dennis, and today I'm going to be covering the War of 1812. And I'm going to talk about the impacts. Of course, the War of 1812 was with the British government, and also going to give the impacts on the Native Americans that were indigenous people that were already here before the colonists came over. So we're going to start out in the War of 1812. The United States took on the greatest naval power in the world, Great Britain, in a conflict that would have immense impact on the young country's future. Causes of the war included British attempts to restrict U.S. trade and the Royal Navy's impressment of the American seamen and America's desire to expand its territory. The United States suffered many costly defeats at the hands of the British, Canadian, and Native American troops over the course of the War of 1812, including the capture and burning of the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., in August of 1814. Nonetheless, American troops were able to repulse British invasion in New York, Baltimore, and New Orleans, boosting national confidence and fostering a new spirit of patriotism. The ratification of the Treaty of Ghent on February 17, 1815, ended the war, but left many of the most contentious questions unresolved. Nonetheless, many in the United States celebrated the War of 1812 as a second war of independence, beginning an era of partisan agreement and national pride. Causes of the war? At the outset of the 19th century, Great Britain locked in a long and bitter conflict with Napoleon Bonaparte's France, an attempt to cut off supplies from reaching the enemy. But both sides attempted to block the United States from trading with the other. In 1807, the British passed the Ordinance and Council, which required neutral countries to obtain a license from its authorities before trading with France or French colonies. The Royal Navy also outraged Americans by its practice of impressment or removing seamen from U.S. merchant vessels, forcing them to serve on behalf of the British. In 1809, the U.S. Congress repealed Thomas Jefferson's unpopular Embargo Act, which by restricting trade had hurt Americans more than either Britain or France. As replacement, the Non-Intercourse Act, which especially prohibited trade with Britain and France, it also proved ineffective and in turn was replaced with a May 1810 bill stating that if either power dropped trade restrictions against the United States, Congress would in turn resume non-intercourse with the opposing power. After Napoleon hinted he would stop restrictions, President James Madison blocked all trade with Britain that November. Meanwhile, new members of Congress elected that year, led by Henry Clay and John C. Calhoun, had begun to agitate for war based on the indignation over British violations of maritime rights, as well as Britain's encouragement of Native American hostility against the American westward expansion. Did you know the War of 1812 produced a new generation of great American generals, including Andrew Jackson, Jacob Brown, and Winfield Scott, and helped propel no fewer than four men to the presidency: Jackson, John Quincy Adams, James Monroe, and William Henry Harrison. Breakout of the War of 1812. In the fall of 1811, Indiana's territorial governor, William Henry Harrison, led U.S. troops to victory in the Battle of Tippecanoe. The defeat convinced many Indians in the Northwest Territory, including the celebrated Shawnee chief Tecumseh, that they needed British support to prevent American settlers from pushing them further out of their lands. Meanwhile, by late 1811, the so-called War Hawks in Congress were putting more and more pressure on Madison, and on June 18, 1812, the president signed a declaration of war against Britain. Though Congress ultimately voted for war, both houses and Senate were bitterly divided on the issue. Most Western and Southern congressmen supported war, while Federalists, especially New Englanders, who relied heavily on trade with Britain, accused war advocates of using the excuse of maritime rights to promote their expansionist agenda. In order to strike at Great Britain, U.S. forces almost immediately attacked Canada, which was then a British colony. American officials were very overly optimistic about the invasion success, especially given how underprepared U.S. troops were at the time. On the other side, they faced a well-managed defense coordinated by Sir Isaac Brock, the British soldier and administrator in charge in Upper Canada, known mainly now as modern Ontario. On August 16, 1812, the United States suffered a humiliating defeat at Brock and Tecumseh's forces, chased those led by Michigan's William Hull across the Canadian border, scaring Hull into surrendering Detroit without any shots fired. Things looked better for the United States in the West as Commodore Oliver Hazard Perry's brilliant success in the Battle of Lake Erie in September of 1813 placed the Northwest Territory firmly under American control. Harrison was subsequently able to retake Detroit with a victory in the Battle of Thames, in which Tecumseh was killed. Meanwhile, the U.S. Navy had been able to score several victories over the Royal Navy in the early months of the war. With the defeat of Napoleon's armies in April 1814, however, Britain was unable to turn its full attention to the war effort in North America. As large numbers of troops arrived, British forces raided the Chesapeake Bay and moved in on the U.S. capital, capturing Washington, D.C. on August 24, 1814, and burning government buildings, including the Capitol and the White House. Inspiration for the Star-Spangled Banner? On September 11, 1814, at the Battle of Plattsburgh on Lake Champlain in New York, the American Navy soundly defeated the British fleet. And on September 13, 1814, Baltimore's Fort McHenry withstood 25 hours of bombardment by the British Navy. The following morning, the fort soldiers hoisted an enormous American flag, a sight that inspired Francis Scott Key to write a poem that would later be set to the music and become known as the Star-Spangled Banner. It was set to the tune of an old English drinking song that would later be adopted as the U.S. national anthem. British forces subsequently left the Chesapeake Bay and began gathering their efforts for a campaign against New Orleans. By that time, peace talks had already begun at Ghent, modern Belgium, and Britain agreed for an armistice after the failure of an assault on Baltimore. In negotiations that followed, the United States gave up its demands to end impressment, while Britain promised to leave Canada's borders unchanged and abandon efforts to create an Indian state in the Northwest. On December 24, 1814, commissioners signed the Treaty of Ghent, which was ratified the following February. On January 8, 1815, unaware that peace had been concluded, British forces mounted a major attack in the Battle of New Orleans, only to meet with defeat at the hands of the future president, Andrew Jackson. News of the battle boosted sagging U.S. morale and left Americans with a taste of victory, despite the fact that the country had achieved none of its pre-war objectives. Impacts of the War of 1812. Though the War of 1812 is remembered as a relatively minor conflict in the United States and Britain, it looms large for Canadians and for Native Americans, who see it as a decisive turning point in their losing struggle to govern themselves. In fact, the war had a far-reaching impact in the United States, as the Treaty of Ghent ended decades of bitter partisan infighting in government and ushered in the so-called era of good feelings. The war also marked the demise of the Federalist Party, which had been accused of being unpatriotic for its anti-war stance, and reinforced a tradition of Anglophobia that had begun during the Revolutionary War. Perhaps most importantly, the war's outcome boosted national self-confidence and encouraged the growing spirit of American expressionism that would shape the better part of the 19th century. The conflict was their last best chance for outside military help to protect their homelands from the westward. This was why the War of 1812 was a turning point for Native Americans. Just 3 decades after the United States broke free from Great Britain with the American Revolution, the two nations once again went into the battle in the War of 1812. But this time, the combatants with the most stake were arguably a third group, Native Americans. At the time the war broke out, the young American nation had been aggressively expanding westward, pitting indigenous people and their ancestral homelands under relentless attack. Seeking military allies to help protect their territory, most Native Americans chose to fight on the side of the British. Indian warriors, many of whom rallied under the powerful and charismatic leader, Tecumseh, played a crucial role in many battles. An offshoot of a prolonged, bitter conflict between Great Britain and Napoleonic France, the War of 1812 pitted the naval superpower, England, against its former colony, the country, and its veritable infancy. Post-independence and the relationship wasn't going well. The U.S. chafed at Britain's oppressive trade restrictions designed to keep the fledgling nation from supporting the French war effort. Nor did Americans like how their merchant seamen were being abducted and forced into service for the British Royal Navy. For its part, Great Britain sought to curb U.S. territorial growth, especially in the direction of Canada, its remaining colonial foothold on the North American continent. The British saw Indian territory as a crucial buffer against U.S. aggression and had already shown support to an increasingly militant tribal coalition along the Great Lakes frontier. In June of 1812, the U.S. President James Madison signed a declaration of war against Britain, initiating the War of 1812. And for Native people who had seen their homeland steadily usurped by white soldiers and settlers, the war would be their last best chance for outside military help and a decisive turning point in their struggle for sovereignty. In the early years of the 19th century, Native Americans and First Nations people, which are the Canadian indigenous population, had to choose which powers to align themselves with and which to fight against. Atrocities committed against the Native communities by U.S. settlers in the name of manifest destiny, the idea that God ordained them to spread democracy and capitalism across the new continent, predisposed many Native warriors toward the British. After war was declared, the Shawnee chief Tecumseh quickly joined the fight. Tecumseh, born in a frontier territory in the Ohio Valley, had long held on an open grudge against American military forces, who had killed both his father, Kukushkinwa, in 1774, and years later, his older brother and mentor, Chusikaw, as a teenager. Tecumseh joined the tribe's war chief, Blue Jacket, to fight the U.S. Army. In 1791, Tecumseh helped defeat General Arthur St. Clair's forces at Battle of Wabash. But its decisive loss at Fallen Timbers in the Northwest Ohio in 1794 resulted in a treaty forcing Indians to cede a major swath of territory from Ohio to Michigan. Tecumseh refused to sign, believing that no one tribe could own the land. Sell a country. Why not sell the air, the great sea, as well as the earth? He once proclaimed in the speech. Did not the Great Spirit make them all for the use of his children? How can we have confidence in the white people, especially when such great acts of injustice have been committed by them upon our race? In 1808, along with his brother, Tenskwatawa, Tecumseh found in Prophetstown, an indigenous village in present-day Indiana, centered in a traditional Native values and lifeways. Hoping to unite indigenous people against the invading white settlers, the Shawnee chief organized a multi-tribe alliance across the Ohio Valley, seeking to expand it. He traveled widely among the other troops in the Great Lakes and the Mississippi Valley, going as far as Canada and as far south as the Gulf of Mexico. Using interpreters, the charismatic orator convinced many to set aside previous differences to unite against the imminent threat posed to their lands, their culture, and their freedom. According to Fisco, warriors from more than a dozen nations answered Tecumseh's call from the Peoria and Ottawa in the north. To the Muscogee and Creek in the south. Even if you couldn't understand his words, you could understand his feelings. All his passionate recruitment served Tecumseh well. On August 16, 1812, he and his Indian army joined forces led by Sir Isaac Brock to deal a moral, crushing loss to the U.S. Army in the siege of Fort Detroit. The victory gave the British and their indigenous allies firm control of the territory around the Great Lakes and pushed the frontier border back eastward at least for a time. After fighting several more battles alongside the British, including the ultimately unsuccessful siege of Fort Meigs in 1813, Tecumseh fell at the Battle of Thames. General Isaac Brock, a British commander who had relied on Tecumseh's support, said of the chief, "A more sagacious or a gallant warrior does not, I believe, exist." William Henry Harrison, who was governor of Indiana, had squared off with Tecumseh in tense territorial negotiations and later led the U.S. soldiers to burn down Prophetstown in the famed Battle of Tippecanoe. Had both fear and respect for the Shawnee chief. He called him one of those uncommon geniuses which springs up occasionally to produce revolutions and overturn the established order of things. Tecumseh's death dealt a major blow to the Native American morale and halted tribal momentum in resisting American westward expansion. Crestfallen by the leader's death, many Native nations ceded their territories and relocated to government-imposed reservations. And as in previous and later wars, the cash-strapped American government, unable to pay its own soldiers, instead doled out portions of formerly Native territory to white veterans in the form of land grants. For many Native Americans from Canada to the Deep South, that was fomented disruption and division. The war fomented disruption and division. Early in the war, with much of Britain's military busy fighting Napoleon's troops, U.S. forces lost little time in attacking Canada. Unwillingly caught in the crossfire, the Mohawk community of Oksani, the only First Nations community that sits astride the U.S. Canadian border along the St. Lawrence River, their territory became the site of several skirmishes. And while some chose the American side of the conflict, many warriors from the Oksani and the neighboring Kanakwa, recruited by the British, had been credited with helping prevent the U.S. conquest of Canada. Oksani was a strategic location for American and British forces, writes historian Darien Bonaparte, tribal preservation officer for the St. Regis Mohawk tribe. There were a number of individuals who ended up in the fight, some of them paying the ultimate price for doing so. Further south in Alabama, the war led into intertribal conflict among the Creek. One faction, Red Sticks, had been inspired by Tecumseh to resist American intrusion, while the other faction, the Lower Creeks, generally supported the U.S. after the militant Red Sticks successfully attacked the American garrison at Fort Sims in 1813, killing hundreds. Major General Andrew Jackson's and his 3,300 strong militia, which included some Cherokee and Lower Creek warriors, retaliated at the Battle of Horseshoe Bend, disseminating several Red Stick towns. The disaster effectively squashed Native resistance in the region. At the Treaty of Fort Jackson that followed, the Creeks surrendered more than 20 million acres of their homeland, nearly half of today's Alabama. The final blow to Native people would come at the end of the war, during the signing of the Treaty of Ghent on December 24, 1814, with the conflict essentially ending in a draw. The Americans and British agreed to return to the pre-war status quo. In doing so, the British abandoned their Native allies. Without financial and military backing, the indigenous resistors became far less successful in defending their own homeland. After the war, the United States began accelerating the pace of the treaties with various Indian nations, negotiating more than 200 agreements that resulted in the massive seceding of national native lands and the creation of reservations across the country. Those who didn't willingly leave their ancestral homelands were forcibly removed and pushed into deadly journeys such as the Southern Tribes' Trail of Tears and the Navajo's Long Walk. As many historians have pointed out, with the War of 1812 ending in a draw, the conflict's only real losers were the American Indians. So that's my take on the War of 1812 and its effect on the Native American community. And next week, I should be going into doing the presidency of James Madison and covering some information on that. I'm still looking for subscribers. I have 51 subscribers now. I'm shooting for 500 by the end of the year. Please pass the word out there about my videos. They have a lot of history in them, a lot of information. The high schoolers can use this information, studying American history in high school. And I'm trying to get the word out so that everybody can see what has really happened in our progression from being just a colony to becoming the vibrant nation that we are today. So, without further ado, from my family and yours, I bid you adieu for next week. And God bless America.